Hello and welcome to the podcast. I, as always, am Anthony, and joining me today is the lovely Zach.
Hello.
And Jarrett.
Salutations, Internet.
We are a bi-monthly podcast, and if this is your first time joining us, we post on the 1st and 15th of every month. We always talk about either one specific anime or a broad subject. Today we are going to be talking about powers and abilities in anime and different shows. We should probably start out with what we were talking about last week, last session, which is JoJo's Bizarre Adventure and Hamon. Very simple power, essentially. It does a few things, but it does what it's needed to do.
Simple when it comes to, you know, sunlight energy that you get through breathing.
That you can then make a giant paraglider out of leaves and...
Yeah, throw
and frogs.
And throw bubble blades, you know.
Oh god, yeah, the bubble blades. Gonna love talking about that next week.
And you can also, what was it that Joseph did? He just like infused his entire body with it. He made like a protective shield.
Did he?
Yeah, he did that at the skipping ahead a little bit, but yeah, he did it at the end of part 3.
I don't remember that. A lot of parts of part 3 are like just a fucking fever dream to me.
It was in the final fight, like before what happens to him, he was like, I've coated my entire body in Hamon.
Dio still just, yeah. Alright, anyway, we'll get to that when we get to that. Well, we can talk about this now. Another power ability from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, Stands. Either one of you two wants to explain exactly what those are.
Oh, yeah. Alright, so Stands are fighting spirits that represent your inner psyche or whatever. I don't know, they change all the time.
Oh god, they do insane shit for no reason, and then Araki forgets how they work, and then they completely change how they do it.
Also, yeah, sometimes they represent the character, like their backstory, their history, or something. Or sometimes they're just completely random.
Yeah.
And we have no idea.
And they range from abilities, like, very simple, like, there's one from, like, part 7, which hasn't been animated yet, called Hey Ya, which is just, it gives you, like, motivational speeches. It doesn't actually do anything. There's no fighting ability. I don't know if it's, like, indestructible or not. I think it is.
And then, like, there are, like, a million different ways you can get a stand.
Oh, god, yeah. Like, in the base universe, you can get it through, like, arrows or... just like what traumatic events
I think yeah like yeah you can get it like just from something important happening in your life, like you can, you know, like something like traumatic can happen to you or something, or you can like get it like through experience like Torino did,
or you could just be born with it like fucking was it Kakyoin? Or Kakyoin and the fucking Polnareff,
right?
I think they're born with theirs.
Yeah, because like I remember, like Polnareff was saying that like he could use Chariot from a very, very young age, and Kakyoin also was his thing. It's like,
but
like,
they
know I can see this friend, but no one else can, so it makes me feel very lonely.
But they never talk about like Kakyoin. Trauma, so it makes me feel like were their parents stand users and they just never talked about it, or
I mean, Polnareff. I mean, I guess. Nah, I guess that was much later that his whole tragedy happened, but that was well after he had the stand.
Also, I'm just kind of realizing this. Did Polnareff become a sword fighter because of Silver Chariot?
I mean, probably some underlying stuff there, but it's not really said directly, so I don't know.
Like
the
I
other
thought,
thing was...
Oh, I always thought it was the other way around, where he became a sword fighter and then he unlocked his stand, and he's like, well, since I'm a sword fighter, my stand must be a sword fighter, but now it's the other way around, and I'm like, what the fuck is going on?
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Well, that's the thing with stands. Like, they're not just... It's weird in how they occur, because I don't feel like there is a clearly defined either way to get a stand or who has a stand. It just kind of seems like it's random.
I mean, it's clearly defined, but there's 10 clearly defined ways.
Yeah, like the devil's palm, the corpse parts, the arrows, traumatic events... The wall eyes, apparently.
Oh,
We're never getting back to that plot point.
Don't talk about part eight.
and this is the part of the podcast where I'm lost because guys are so far ahead.
It will never make sense, and I'm
Stance in general don't make sense. There's a clearly like defined rule set to what stance should and shouldn't be able to do, and they break them all the time.
For every rule of a stand, there's a stand that breaks this rule and then some. Like, oh yeah, stands must protect their users. There are literally stands that are designed to kill their fucking user.
Yeah.
Isn't that like Cheap Trick?
Yeah, Cheap Trick is one of them. He's also one of the ones where you don't need a stand user for him to exist.
Also, Cheap Trick also breaks a rule because you can't have two stands unless Cheap Trick is one of your stands.
So stupid. Yeah. Oh.
And then, like, and then coming back to Polnareff. Polnareff, Silver Chariot has armor. How does that work?
Yeah, and he
I'm so sad with that because, speaking of Silver Chariot's armor, you remember the one part, and we're definitely going to get into spoiler, but this whole thing is a fucking spoiler, so yeah, I don't care.
Go watch shit if you're listening to this.
So you remember when Polnareff gets taken over by Anubis, right?
Yeah.
And how...
That's another one where you have two stands now.
Yeah, when he's fighting Star Platinum, and Star Platinum breaks off his shoulder armor, Anubis literally says, oh, I feel much faster now, like I can attack even faster now. Why is that not just an ability of Polnareff that he just clips off the armor? Sure, he's less defendable, but now he's faster.
That is an ability. Yeah.
That he does do that?
Yeah.
I could not remember if he did that or not, and I was so confused.
Yeah, he did it once.
Yeah, I don't remember when he does it, but I know that's ability of his to remove the armor, because that's also one of his abilities in the fighting game. One of his ultimates is that his armor just flies off and he goes super fast.
Why didn't he do that more often? That would have helped him so many times.
Yeah, you know.
Like, literally, you're making a very fast stand faster, nearly to the speed of Star Platinum, if not faster.
I don't remember if they say that Polnareff without armor is fast. Actually, does he use it against Jotaro? Isn't that like the one time he uses it against Jotaro?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking of, because I was like, I feel like he's used it before, because I had a break in between watching the first half of part 3 and the second half. And when that whole part came out with the news, I'm like, didn't Polnareff do this before? But I couldn't fully remember.
I mean, his speed is kind of ambiguous, because there's a whole the Man in the Mirror fight where Kekkoming flips a coin up. It's been shown that Man in the Mirror can move at essentially light speed, and Silver Chariot cut him in half, like, as he was moving in between shit, so...
Yeah.
I don't know. Somebody calculated it up, because there's his attack where it makes it look like he has 7 stands. Somebody, like, added that up to how fast he'd have to be moving, and it was, like, it is such an insane speed, the only thing that could be matched is fucking Made Over Heaven. Or Made in Heaven, not Over Heaven.
Maids in Heaven.
But, we'll get in more into stands in a later episode. But, we should probably move on to something else, like, quirks from My Hero Academia.
Yes.
Oh, boy. The quirks are... I love them personally because they don't explain anything. They're just like, yeah, they just kind of popped up one day.
Yeah, it just popped up, and the only way that we can kind of tell that people are going to get them is, what was the weird reasoning? Like, if their pinky toe is fused?
If your pinky toe bones were fused.
Yeah, then, like, such an odd way of telling that.
And I can't tell if that's him, like, hinting at something, like, later on for some reason, or if it's just, like, he wants a definitive way to show, hey, Deku will never develop powers beyond what he has now.
I think that was mostly the point.
Yeah. Because, I mean, it hasn't been brought up at all afterwards. Like, I feel like it was literally just put in to go, hey, this character is not going to get these naturally.
Main soft boy is not plot quote, relevant unquote,
naturally. However, like, natural quirks are.
Yeah, I mean, it's like random and stupid, but I feel like it was just the author's way. Is like, I need a definitive way to show that Deku is quirkless.
Yeah, it kind of seems like how it is, like more of a plot device than anything.
Yeah, I do thoroughly enjoy quirks and how they and how they work in the world, because what did they say in the show? It's like 80% of all people have quirks?
I think so.
Yeah, it's fairly high.
It's just interesting to see that whole, how that affects the world, because like, one way to think about this is like, how does stands really affect the world of JoJo outside of just the main action that happens to the JoJo characters?
Pretty much nothing.
Yeah, you don't see anyone using a stand to take over the world. You don't see it using it to influence anything outside of these weird stand-on-stand conflicts. In My Hero, quirks are like fucking almost everything.
Everyone they has one.
They help protect people. They help with jobs. They help with damn near everything. So much so that they have like schools for this. Could you imagine if JoJo, if they had a stand, not stand, a school for stands? Sorry, dude, a stand for
the Speedwagon Stand Foundation.
Yeah, like everything in JoJo, as far as stands, is so like low key that it's very surprising, honestly. Which makes me think that like it's a very large opposite to My Hero. Yeah, where I would say it's far less than 20% of people just have stands.
And then one of the cool things about like My Hero is you have people like fucking All Might that could just, if he wanted to, he could just destroy the planet. Like it would take him a little bit, but he could just go around destroying towns. No one could stop him.
Yeah.
Also, I do like the variety. Like, not to say that JoJo doesn't have variety, but My Hero has such a vast variety of just like everything, whether it's like good, bad, or meh.
And they have stuff that's very similar, but definitely does have their differences.
I also like in My Hero, as far as quirks, that they're not just their base elements. You can work and you can train to make your quirk, even though it's still the same quirk, you can make it better or try to make it better or use it in a different way.
Yeah, like
that is helpful. It's not just my power does this and only this. No, I can, like myself, I can learn and evolve and change my quirk to suit what I needed to within reason.
Yeah, the Invisible Girl's definitely a weird example of that, where she developed like some like, it was some like light blinding attack or something.
Oh, her solar flare.
And then Suya like developed the ability to like camouflage herself
for some reason. The Invisible Girl and oh god, Naval Laser Guy, did they ever do like a combo attack? Because that'd be some sick shit.
No, but that'd be cool.
Oh man.
Fucking... He just like fires into her and she just like widens his beam. Just...
Oh man, could you imagine just that?
Turns into like a fan.
Be like their version of the double Detroit smash. Now, it's like, I always wonder, because All for One. I hate that naming scheme, by the way. It's so fucking annoying.
I mean, like, it makes sense, but as a, like, power slash name thing, yes, it is very... It easily can get mixed up. It happens to me all the time.
I always wonder what would happen if you gave One for All to... Fuck, All for One. God damn it. No, I was right the first time, wasn't I?
One for all is the good one, because it's you give it to everybody. All for One is the evil one, because he takes everything to him.
Yeah, so One for All, I always wondered what would happen if you gave that to like somebody like the fucking the Naval Laser Guy. Like, would he just be able to fucking level like the planet? Would he just become like a fucking Death Star essentially? If you could give that ability to somebody else to just enhance their powers, who do you think you would give that one to?
I don't know if it would enhance his powers, though, because, like, it just...
I thought it said that it enhances
all for one.
Well,
I thought it was just a build-up. No, I thought it was just a collection of powers.
It is.
So that's what, like, the physical strength and the was it the air pressure thing?
Well, the thing is all the strength, like, it's kind of confusing because, like, everybody thinks that, like, the quirk is just the passing down thing. The strength comes from the first guy's quirk.
Yeah.
The first guy's quirk was a strength stockpile quirk, and then because that kept getting passed down, that's why it's so strong.
It's very strange. It's cool lore, but it's just very strange.
Yeah. What was your question again? If we could give someone one for all, who would we give it
to? Who would you give it to? Yeah. Like, who would you want to become the next All Might, essentially? That's not Deku.
Ooh.
So I don't know who would fit well with, besides, like, you know, Vermillion.
Yeah.
Like, even I agree that, like, Vermillion with all for, like, one for all would have been really crazy.
Yeah, especially with his fucking ability to just go through shit. But, you know, stuff happens. No spoilers on that, because that's not out yet for anime.
You want to know what my favorite part about quirks are? Is I love, like, how they make them, like, almost, like, realistic. Because, like, you know, in, like, stuff like X-Men, which is, like, very similar, it's, like, these people just have powers, and they just work for, like, no real reason. It's like, oh, I can do this thing, and there's no downsides to it or anything.
Mm-hmm.
But in this universe, like, if you have a power, you have somewhat of a reasonable downside to it. Like, oh, it's like, I can make my, you know, I can create stuff from my body, but I need lipids, so I have to eat a lot.
Yeah, I remember when you said that you were reading it before it ever got animated, and you told me about how Deku would break his limbs every time he used his powers because he was so strong. I was like, that is a fucking cool ass concept, because he has so much power, but he's so weak.
It's like, I have all this power. My body is nowhere near prepared for it, though.
Like all of them have, like, something like that. Like, was it the naval laser? He gets queasy from using it. Like, Sero actually, like, if he shoots too much tape, he gets tired.
Yeah, and fucking, Mineta, there you go. Yeah, he, like, starts bleeding if he plucks too many of them, which is kind of cool. And it gives them, like, realistic things to work on to become stronger, which is really cool, too.
Or how Ida's mufflers will start to, freeze up?
I would love to see x-rays of Ida's fucking legs. I want to know how that works, like, because they're engines, but, like, are they metal, or is it, like...
Oh, I'm going to talk to you about this later. I'm not going to talk about it now, because it's spoilers for the manga, but it's not, like, too bad, but I still don't want to put this here. I'll talk to you about this later, but, yeah, definitely my favorites. I love the diet-based one. They have a lot of diet-based things, like Momo's lipids. Yeah, the one dude has to eat sugar.
Sugar Rush. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, Tetsu. He has to eat a lot of iron heavy diet because his body turns to iron.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. That's cool.
Oh yeah, no. I love that whole explanation with Tetsu. It's just like, yeah, no, I just need to eat a lot of food with iron to keep my metal hard.
Also, greatest name in anime ever.
Tetsu.
It's so hard to say, but I love it.
It's like, Mom and Dad, you guys are assholes for naming me our last name.
His name is literally all four Tetsus. It's just a single Tetsu.
I hope his middle name is
all
not,
four, just Tetsu.
I hope his middle name's not Tetsu as well.
No, they show you his full name. It's just four Tetsus.
Oh, boy.
Tetsu.
So,
like, two groups of two.
Kind of a similar power, I guess, would be semblances from Ruby.
Mm-hmm.
Who, yes, it's not an anime technically, but it's close enough to where we're going to talk about it. So fuck off.
I feel like we should have had that whole discussion in the first episode, or I guess we could do it now, and what we constitute as anime with gigantic quotations, because
stuff like Avatar. Ruby.
For me, it's just anything that's not live action. So yes, that includes Ruby.
Kappa Mikey. I'm kidding.
Anyway, yeah, things like Legend of Korra, Voltron, Thundercats, Genlock.
Like stuff that's obviously close to it, you know?
Yeah, I feel like definitely inspired. Like, I believe that, like, Ruby and Genlock are definitely inspired by Japanese animation, and Avatar, like, anything made by the Avatar studio definitely is.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, isn't a fucking... Wasn't Monty Ohm Japanese?
Yeah, he was part he was part Japanese.
So, it counts, question mark?
It was made by a Japanese person, so
at the very least, it isn't. At the very least, like Zach said, is heavily inspired by anime. Like, Japanese anime, so...
But,
I give it a pass, and it's one of my favorite shows, so I will...
It's definitely, it's a good show. Anyways, we gotta get into semblances back on topic. Yes,
semblances.
Semblances are very similar to quirks, but they don't seem like they have as much of a, like, tax on the body or, like, downsides. Like, occasionally we'll see, like, Weiss get kind of tired.
Yeah, that's the other thing that I like about semblances, is that aside from whatever the schnees are up to, they're random in what you get.
Schnees.
Well, because they even say that, like, all semblances are pretty much random as to what you're going to get, much like a quirk. Except for the schnees, who seems to keep inheriting the inbreeding? Same one. We're not talking about that, alright?
Did a Rocky write this rule set?
Oh, man. If they don't explain that, I'm actually going to be kind of confused, because now that I'm thinking about that, that kind of makes me feel weird.
Because Winter and Weiss still have the same ones, and it just seems to be, like, a thing, plus their semblances are really powerful.
Yeah.
Because, like, not only are they glyphs, but they're also able to summon things.
Yeah, I think Weiss kind of breaks everything, because her stand is just so, like, a lot cooler than everybody's. Like, everybody's like, oh, I do this thing. Weiss is just like, I do everything.
I have a stand.
Also, real quick, yeah, we talk about JoJo so much, so if we call another power a stand, it's just gonna happen, so just...
yeah. Up. I mean, but to be fair, Weiss basically... does have a stand.
She pretty much, yeah, she, like, with the giant with Night bee Boy, or yeah. Night Boy, or...
I mean, even the, yeah, the bee.
Yeah.
It's so weird. And then we got stuff like Ruby, who, she barely ever uses hers.
She uses hers a lot, especially in the more recent, because it's super speed.
Not
it's
as, super well, not speed as much as, like, Weiss, though.
No, I mean, Weiss is basically built upon her semblance. Yang uses her all the time, Blake uses hers probably about the same amount of time.
I kind of wish that they did the same thing that My Hero does, where they have personal training to, like, you know, enhance their semblance. Because, like, it'd be kind of cool to just see Yang taking, like, a baseball bat to the stomach and then just, all right, hit me again. You know, like, some cool shit like that. But, I don't know.
But, I mean, but then you get the ones that are, like, crows, where, how do you train that?
Yeah, crow. Oh,
there's no...
he doesn't want to train it. He wants it weaker.
No. He does.
Yeah. Crow's is weird because, like,
real quick, his is bad luck. So things
literal aura of bad luck.
Yeah, like, yeah, but Crow's is weird because you never really think about, like, you never really think about having active or passive semblances. But Crow's is technically a passive one. He doesn't control it. It just works.
It just works. It's really, I don't want to say, like, weird, but his is definitely a very unique based power.
Yeah, his is very, well, I mean, totally. Nora's is also passive. She just has the ability to absorb electricity.
I mean, Yang's is
she survived kind of? Being, yeah, they're like a passive with an active component. Because Nora can really take
Crow's
a lightning strike.
Just always active, though.
It's his is just always passive.
He wish he could just turn it off. I like how they kind of hinted towards
Velvet.
It when you... Velvet's...
Velvet's
oh, yeah,
is also
she is
passive.
Technically always learning. That's... Yeah.
Because she is basically Taskmaster.
I like how they kind of hinted towards Crow's semblance of being bad luck, where you just, like, you know, somebody would drop a cup, and, like, you just be like, all right, that's kind of weird, but you never, you know, thought about it. And then when you learned about it, you rewatch it, you're like, it's happening.
Yeah. Also, I do like to point out that even though we're talking about semblances, Ruby does just straight up have magic in the show.
Yeah.
They have legitimate magic that seems to have no...
downsides? Question mark?
Not downside. It has no limitations, it seems. It just seems that you can pretty much do whatever you want, which is going to get me talking about hard and soft magic systems. But that one is very much what seems to be a soft magic system. It has no very well-defined limitations, no costs... or, like,
Yeah, like I'm very curious
as
to like what Salem's limits. Salem is like the main villain of the show. I'm really curious as to what like her limits of that magic actually is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's also like, weird because like Oz, when he had his magic, he gave it to four other women, yeah. gave it to four women, and thus we have the maidens. So clearly, this doesn't have like a
yeah, like Salem can't snap her fingers and fucking Ruby's head explodes. Like she obviously has to kind of
yeah,
there are some kind of limitations.
Well, what about right. that? What about that one teacher where her semblance is just magic?
Oh no, hers is just telekinesis.
Yeah, but it's weird because she like also fixes stuff. I don't.
Yeah, it'd be cooler... her telekinesis works like it's reversing time, which is strange. But
it'd be cooler if her semblance was like she can put things back to how they were before, because it would actually fit better with what she's been shown to do.
Which is literally just fixing things.
Well, no, because then her very first time. Fighting Cinder, she sent back her projectile, so I guess that wouldn't work.
Yeah, which everyone forgets about. I even forget about that first fight with Glinda.
Yeah, it's weird. I always forget how early we see Glinda too. She's
like, first episode.
First episode, like right like at the beginning.
She's like first 5 minutes.
Yeah, it's like Ruby and then Glinda.
Yeah.
What other cool semblances are there? I'm trying to think. We got the one that can just disguise. Is his what's his face? Ren? Can he only hide himself from Grimm, or is it
no?
Anyone?
He's been able to boost it with John's.
Oh, that's right, John.
Since John's, because he was able to do that entire train, I believe, or train car. I think it was just the train car.
Yeah, it was just the one cart.
At the beginning of part six, which at the time of us recording, we are waiting on volume
seven. Yeah.
It's volume, thank you.
Yeah, you know, same thing.
Yeah, more or less.
I'm interested. I hope there's, like, some cooler, more... I don't want to say broken, but I hope there's, like, some really weird uses of it. Because, like, what I like about JoJo and My Hero to an extent is, like, people with really obscure and weird powers can use them in super broken ways.
Oh.
Yeah, I feel like Ren's is a little bit too, like, weirdly specific. It doesn't really seem like it does anything else other than that.
Yeah.
It fits with his character, at least, because he tries to be a very calm person. By the way, I did think of someone else who has a passive semblance, Calavera, with her
her pre-flex.
Insane perception reflexes. Because she's basically completely aware of everything around her, which is handy, given that you're mostly blind, but very... very fitting for her.
I like
seems in her current state.
It feels like technology isn't that prevalent in this world, but they just have cyborgs like everywhere.
Ruby is indeed a very interesting mix of a setting with very, very fragmented cities.
Like they don't have satellites, but they have
tremendous technology. Yeah, they barely have communication towers. They barely basically have the internet.
They have like four towers that communicate together, and if one of them goes down, then the whole system's kaput.
Yeah, but then they have fucking cyber eyes and a robotic arm that works perfectly fine. Maybe you should kind of focus on like, you know, sending a car to space, like hire some Elon Musk motherfucker to, you know, get your program together.
Yeah, the freaking super soldier robots.
Oh god, it's like...
And the mechs.
I get it, your world's dangerous, but maybe some more communication would help out a little bit.
I mean, that's what they're trying to do, but, like... Yeah, Rui's a very interesting setting of just, like... It has moments of high-tech, moments of near-fantasy and stuff, especially in the wilderness between parts 4 and... going into 7 now.
That's another thing I was curious about with their magic system is, did everyone have the same kind of magic? Or was it like...
As far as I could tell, what little bit we got in that lore dump.
Yeah, like mostly we've seen Salem and Ozpin's like magic actually extended, but we've seen brief stuff. So I'm actually curious as to like, can everyone do this?
Yeah, because even in that lore dump, it was pretty much like everybody had magic. Like most everyone had the ability to do magic, because even when they come to fight the gods, a lot of people are just casting spells, just straight up to...
Now, that brings up the question is, I don't think Ozpin and Salem would have been the strongest magic users. Who the fuck was the strongest back then before they wiped everyone out?
We don't know. Maybe we will. Maybe we will. I have to say, if we can spend an entire episode on Ruby. We probably will in the future. So absolutely. Switch over.
What you're doing? Goblin Slayer? Because I know Zach wanted to talk about their magic system because it's very unique for a show.
I am interested in this now that you brought it up.
Yeah, it's not a lot to talk about, but like it is like for what little it is very interesting because it's in Goblin Slayer. Like I feel like this is the most interesting part about Goblin Slayer with it's got like its ups and its downs, but like I love the magic system because it's like you can tell whoever made Goblin Slayer definitely based a lot of it on D&D, and you can tell that from the magic system, which works exactly like D&D.
Yeah, like the phrase, like, how many spells do you have left is not really a thing that you would, especially because they're like, if it was like, oh yeah, no, I have to use this thing to cast this spell, no, it's like she's just straight up praying, and she's like, no, I can't do that, like, I only have one of these left. So it is very D&D heavy.
Yeah, the acknowledgement of the limited amount of stuff that they can do is nice and refreshing, whereas like other like I'll just say like other like isekai stuff is like their magic is just like I can keep doing this all day.
Yeah, it's like I kind of like how Goblin Slayer is like if she uses let's say her third like the because the main character is like I say one of the main characters is a girl who's a priestess and yeah. She has she's essentially a cleric and she has like she has about three miracles she can perform a day. And so let's say she would use up her third, she'd be fuck out of magic. Like, she can't push herself harder to get, no, she's out of magic. But, like, in other animes, it'd be like, I think I can muster up one more to defend us, you know?
Yeah.
So it's
just enough plot strength to get that one extra oof out.
And it adds a real risk, too.
Yeah. I'm wondering if, I don't know, I never, like, really checked out the books or anything, but I'm wondering if they explain it a little bit more, because they never explain it in the anime, because, like, literally, like, the first time they ever talk about it, it's, like, in the beginning, in the cave, where he asks her, like, how many spells do you have left? And she's like, I have one, and is like, okay. And, like, you're like, wait, what? And then, like, you know, you assume just, you learn, not from them explaining it to you, but for them showing you, which is a good example for literally anything in media needs to do more, is that, like, they have kind of, like, D&D spell slots. Like, for the day, they get to use a specific amount of spells.
Now, like,
somehow they know it.
Yeah, now I'm curious as to, like, when they level up, essentially, do they know that they have more spells? Do they know that they've achieved the ability to cast one more spell a day?
I think she did, because didn't she go from 2 to 3?
But how does she know that? Like, did she, like, blind dream or something?
She was gifted a different ability, which is when she could do the whole wall of protection thing. In episode 2? Yeah, it was, like, episode 2.
I don't know. I would love to see the gods of that world and just how they fucking work. Just a bunch of...
It's a lot of rolling dice.
But yeah. but like, that's what I'm wondering, is that, like, you know... It was like, did it come to her in a dream? Did, like, the goddess actually, like, straight up tell her how many spells she has and what spells she has? And then, like, how does it work for non-clerics? Like, how does it work for a wizard? Do they just practice the spells and, like, they kind of just learn their limits?
Probably, but the one wizard that we see in the show, she doesn't really ever talk about her stuff.
Oh, she's cool. But she definitely says, like, this took me a long time to make when she gives him that one scroll. So it's like she's
the
definitely
one of water stuff. Yeah.
Oh, that's so cool. We should probably talk about that. Fucking Goblin Slayer, the greatest tactitioner of all time, fucking has like this scroll that, what is it, the other end of it? Like, it's a teleportation scroll essentially, but the other end of it's at like the bottom of a sea. So when he opens it up, it like shoots a blade of water because of the high pressure.
Yeah. God, Goblin Slayer is. I like it more than I should. Like, I feel like it should be bad, but it's just so cool because Goblin Slayer is such a cool character. Like, he's just so calm, collected, and, like, smart. Like, he's not smart, he's wise. Like, he knows, he's very good at, like, knowing ways to take care of goblins, and that's it.
And in this, you know, kind of ties back to what you were saying before of show don't tell. They never say, oh, Goblin Slayer's so wide. No, they show an episode where he is learning shit and he then uses it for later stuff. And you're just like, ah. Mm.
I mean, even with the fact that he is crazy beyond a shadow of a doubt, he is good at what he does, and he is brilliant at what he does, which is killing goblins.
Yeah, I love the world makes fun of him, too. They're like, it's like, all he does is kill goblins, he can't be strong. While he's doing all this, like, crazy stuff, he's like, alright, like, I love how he likes to work alone, but when he has a party, he utilizes them to their fullest potentials.
Oh, I know.
Like, he was like, I'm gonna set this fire, you put a magic wall here so they all suffocate to death.
It's so fucked up. But it's so good. Alright, we're talking about Goblin Slayer. We keep doing this, like, we talk about the magic system, we trail into the actual anime. Let's talk about Devil Fruit next, because that'd be Zach's specialty. I know very little about Devil Fruit.
Same.
Oh, yeah. So Devil Fruits are really cool. In the One Piece universe, Devil Fruits are they're fruit that are cursed. They're cursed. Like, that's why they're called Devil Fruits, because people believe that they're cursed by the devil. And, like, they come in three types. What is it? Parmesia, which is kind of you alter your body or reality or the world around you in multiple ways. Logia, which is elemental based, which lets you engulf your body with your element to essentially become invincible to most attacks. And then there's Zone, which is just animal based, where you turn into, you gain abilities based on your animal and can become a giant version of it.
Out of, like, the few episodes I've actually seen of One Piece, I remember it was the weird captain with the big nose that has the slow beam fruit, who's like a boxer, and he has like a bunch of animal crew. Oh god, like, they're very creative with how they use their abilities too. Like, it's something very simple, but they use it very well.
There's, like, you know, characters have, like, interesting ways to use their abilities, like, you know, Luffy just can just stretch his body, but, like, I mean, I'm not getting into Gears, because the Gears are, as much as I love One Piece, the Gears are stupid, but,
what,
like,
are Gears?
Luffy essentially has powered-up modes called Gears, which they just don't make any sense. But then Luffy just uses his abilities in, like, really cool ways. Like, one of my favorites is just, like, Gum Gum Bell, where he just stretches his neck, like, really far away, and then just headbutts them really hard.
and like, I love how it's like, yeah, anybody can get these abilities, but you have to either have money or have the ability to find one of these fucking fruits.
Yeah. Which is pretty much, like, only one of each. Like, basically, whatever fruit you're getting that's the only one, pretty much.
Yeah, like only one of a fruit exists in the world at a time. Like, there's only one, flame fruit, but there could be similar ones. Like, there can be a lava fruit, or, like, things that are similar to that. Like, but there's only one of each type.
Like, didn't you say that somebody has Luffy's powers, but just better?
Oh yeah. Okay. I'll get into Katakuri and how fucking awesome he is in a bit, but there's still, like, a little bit more to talk about. So, like, essentially, when a person with a devil fruit ability dies, their power returns to the world, and a random fruit somewhere will then turn into that devil fruit.
Oh, that's cool. I didn't know.
Yeah, they actually, like, show it in, like, the thing where it just shows an apple and it just, like, twists and becomes a fruit.
See, I like the idea of devil fruits, because I just like how they're set up. They give you these fantastical powers that make you great at stuff, but they do have a good cost, which is you will drown if you are in, was it knee-high water?
Yeah.
You will just, no matter if you're just knee deep in water, you will just start to sink into the ground and drown.
That is horrifying.
Yeah, because the devil fruit are apparently cursed by the sea, so they have multiple weaknesses. One of them being if you get to knee deep water, your body will just feel like you won't be able to move your body very much. Like you'll just feel like lead. You won't be able to use your abilities either. So if Luffy fell in the water, he can't stretch his way out. He'll just become dead weight.
Has anybody died in the universe that way? Like in the universe that way, I should say.
No important characters have. There might have been like smaller characters that might have died that way, but I don't, none that I can think of.
Because I love the idea. It's like, oh no, an enemy pirate, just shove him off the boat, fucking dead.
Yeah. And then there's another weakness is Sea Stone, because Sea Stone is connected to the sea, so essentially Sea Stone is like just an interesting way that like you could beat a Devil Fruit user, because obviously like in anything you just be like, oh, I caught the bad guy, but he used his teleportation Devil Fruit to just leave. But no, like Sea Stone's like if you have Sea Stone cuffs, you can cuff someone and then they can't use their power anymore.
Wow.
Yeah, so like a lot of Marines use like Sea Stone weapons, like a Smoker. Smoker uses like he has these like metal rods that are tipped with Sea Stone, so he can just beat the shit out of Devil Fruit users.
Like the idea of police brutality in the fucking One Piece universe.
I also like that if you have a Devil Fruit and you're fighting someone who has if you're fighting someone that has like your weakness, like if you're like a fire, you're fighting against a water type, or no, not a water type. Let's say you're a plant type Devil Fruit user and you're fighting a fire type Devil Fruit user. You're weak to them because like it's whatever. It's the opposite element, and or if it's just a better version of your thing, like you said, the lava, like a fire person.
Yeah.
Can't really be affected by most things, but if they fight a lava person, which lava is stronger than fire, then they're susceptible to them.
Huh.
Yeah. Because in like your Devil Fruit, like it's mostly with Logia, but Paramecia tend to fit under this as well. That they'll have their own like they're naturally like weaknesses or resistances, like Jared said, if a plant could be beat by fire because that just makes sense. But then like if someone has a better version, like lava being hotter than fire, they win. But then like Luffy, since he, even though he doesn't have a Logia, because he's made out of rubber, he's resistant to electricity.
Oh yeah, because when he fights what's his face? I have no idea what his name is. The big fucking fuck you god of lightning.
Yeah, I forget his name too, but yeah, he had like a lightning devil fruit, and he's like my devil fruit's invincible, and then he just strikes Luffy and he's like, your power doesn't work on me.
Yeah, because I was doing my research on Skypeans for the D&D game that we're doing eventually, and I did like quite a bit of research on him too, because I guess he is part Skypean, or he is Skypean, which is one of the races in One Piece. He had like no idea what rubber was, so he's like, "Well, how the hell can you fucking resist me? What is rubber?" could you imagine though? Like you're like, "Oh sweet, I finally got a devil fruit," and you eat it, and you turn into like a giraffe guy. Like how pissed off would you be?
I mean, given with that one, there is like the hybrid forms, so you can like change different aspects of yourself if you have the zone fruit.
Yeah,
like, that's what Chopper does. Like Chopper will just change into like in between versions of human and reindeer.
Well, I mean, it's like depending on what animal it is. Like if you're a lion man, that's pretty badass. But it's like if you're a shitty animal, then like
I'm a sheep.
Well, that's what I love what you say about that. Is you say giraffe, but then like we have seen a guy with a giraffe devil fruit, and he was actually really badass.
Of course. What happens if somebody eats two devil fruits?
We've never been shown it, but it's been told in the lore that if you eat two devil fruit, the powers will essentially kill themselves and you.
Oh, wow. Okay. So, like, will they not be reborn as another devil fruit, or will it...
I think the devil fruits will still be reborn, but they will... The two devil fruits will essentially fight inside you and kill each other, and kill you. It's actually... We actually learned that from a scene with the giraffe guy, where they're getting their devil fruit, and, like, both of them have devil fruit, and they're, like, they're worried, because they're like, oh... It was like, it said two devil fruits shouldn't be near each other. And it's like, oh, that's not how it works. It's like, if you eat two devil fruits, you will die. They will kill you from the inside.
I like how I picked the two most random aspects I could think of, and they both kind of connect in some way.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
And then there's also another thing that I don't fully understand in the lore, which is awakened devil fruit, where you can essentially become even, like... If you awaken your devil fruit, it becomes, like, more powerful. Like, zone users, if they awaken their devil fruit, they become, like, weird hybrid animals. I think we've only really seen it from, the guards of Impel Down. But then, my favorite character, Katakuri, he awakened his Mochi devil fruit, essentially letting him turn his body into Mochi.
Mochi is...
It's like a Japanese, like, white rice thing. It's, like, kind of, like, gooey.
Oh, okay, yeah. Is that the guy that you were talking about that's better than Luffy?
Yeah, he fights Luffy, and then, like, everything Luffy does, Katakuri just does better. Like, Luffy has that move where he punches really fast, but Katakuri is like, I don't have to punch really fast, I just make a bunch of fists.
That works. Oh, God. Yeah, devil fruit's definitely a very interesting aspect, and I hope that we... Because I've seen some stuff on it, because I watched, like, half of a video just, to, you know, showing off some of the cool devil fruits. But I'm down to watch 800 episodes of One Piece.
But, one thing I like about, you know, One Piece is that, like, even though, obviously, devil fruit are so cool, they're not the be-all, end-all. The other power is Haki, which essentially is, they introduced in the series to essentially give non-Devil Fruit users a chance.
Go ahead.
Yeah, there are three types of Haki. There's Armament Haki, which lets you pretty much cover your body or weapons with steel, making either giving yourself really good defense or really good offense. And it works really well against Devil Fruit users, and is pretty much the only way to hit Logia users. And then there's Observation, which increases your senses, letting you see, hear, smell really far, or even see into the future. Yeah. And then there's Conquerors, which just lets you essentially overcome people's willpower, make them give up.
And then can these be used in tandem with Devil Fruit, or is this a...
Yes, you can have both. As much as I don't like this because it makes Luffy a little bit too overpowered, Luffy also has all three Haki.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
Oh.
If you think that's bad, wait till we get to me talking about Bleach.
God.
It gets really bad.
Yeah, Luffy has all three. Luffy has all three Haki. Even in his fight with Katakuri, he started getting the ability to see in the future, so he's honing his observation Haki as well.
Wow. Huh.
Conquerors is super rare, but yeah, you go on.
Talking about the neat, like, limitations and weaknesses of devil fruit was making me think of Full Metal and their alchemy.
Yeah.
And, you know, inserts law equivalent exchange clip here.
You're gonna have to explain Full Metal, because I don't actually know how the powers in Full Metal work.
Their magic, quote unquote, is called alchemy, but it's kind of how normal alchemy is. And it requires the law of equivalent exchange, which we should insert the clip, but for this, it's in order to gain something, you need something of equal value.
So a good example is there's, like, a broken radio. They put all the pieces into essentially, like, a circle. that has like a bunch of lines strategically drawn, and then they activate it, and then the radio's fixed because nothing really changed. It's just the order of how stuff was put together is now different.
Yeah. Did they actually do that?
Yes.
That is that's one of the first episodes. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like one of the first. That's how
it was like the radio was like shattered because it had like fallen on the ground. So it was broken. So it was like going to take forever to repair. And because I think it was like some shop owner that they had made mad.
They were in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, it's like, oh no, we can fix this. Just draw. Alphonse just draws his sigil or whatever for his alchemy and just kind of, and there you go.
Yeah, so typically they have to draw like a sigil either on the ground or something along those lines. Like other characters have like special ones, but it's you have to have the sigil to activate the power, but the main guy can just do it.
Yeah, well, I mean, he had to go through a very traumatic and awful event in order to.
Yeah, like they explain that... why, but.
Well, I mean, for Zach, do you care about spoilers for this one? Okay, so basically. Edward and Alphonse are brothers. Their mom tragically passes away due to a sickness, I believe. So, and she's their dad, who was a very kind of mysterious figure, they learn that he was an alchemist. So, they think that they can bring her back by getting all of the stuff that a human body contains, you know, like component-wise, like salt and
water,
protein and stuff like that. Yeah,
I remember shit goes wrong.
Oh yeah, so they do this. They think that they have it all figured out. They're like, well, we have all the things that like a human has, like what the physical makeup of a human is, so we should be able to get our mom back. They do it, and like you said, shit goes wrong. Alphonse completely loses his body and loses his leg. Or no, sorry,
he loses his leg.
He then drags himself over to a suit of armor that they have, and in his own blood, he then marks his symbol in the armor to then keep Alphonse's soul in the armor, and in doing that, he also loses his arm.
Yeah.
For that exchange.
Do they ever explain how, because the cybernetic stuff that they have in that world works?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But then... we'll explain this in a minute, but when he travels to the other world, they don't work anymore. So does alchemy have something to do with how the fucking robot parts work?
Maybe. I'm not 100% sure, because they never fully explained it.
No, they really don't.
But I love Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood, specifically, is one of my all-time favorite animes, because even the magic system, in this case alchemy, has very clear defined rules and stuff. You cannot do X or you cannot do Y if you don't do X.
And Zach, I want to tell you
very specific like exceptions, which is like you have to do something horrible in order to get this tremendous power that like that Ed has. Yeah, I had to bring back an abomination that I thought was my mother. Nearly killed my brother and had to basically put his soul into a suit of armor. Meanwhile, I also severely lost my leg and arm and almost bled out from it.
I want to tell Zach about Mustang just because I think Zach's gonna like him. So, the sigil is on the back of his glove, so he can just activate it whenever, but he has these special gloves that when he snaps, it creates a spark because of the fabric rubbing on each other. So his signature move is he turns the air into, like, a form of gas, and then he snaps and just creates these explosions.
That's fucking rad.
it's fucking sick.
Yeah, I love his design, because he's the funniest-looking anime character I've seen.
There's one guy that doesn't make it very far who he's, like, he's known as, like, the gun something. His whole thing is he makes, like, he turns the ground into, like, cannons, essentially.
Oh, and, the iron alchemist?
Yeah, I fucking love him. He's so cool.
Since you talk about him, that also means we gotta bring up Scar, because Scar, his whole alchemy is...
He stops halfway. Yeah, he stops, doesn't he? He stops halfway through the transmutation thing.
No. His whole thing, at least in Brotherhood, is... his brother was working on whatever the other countries, like, it was still alchemy, but it was a slightly different way of alchemy. Basically, he has these just markings on his arms, and one side is destruction, the other is creation, and I think he actually lost one of his arms. He took, when his brother died, he took his brother's arm and used the creation one, I think, to fuse it to his arm, to the remaining part of his arm. So he has like a very odd like score line on one of his arms.
I was about to say, the way they explain it in the other version is that essentially there's like three steps to the alchemy process. Is you make the circle, you essentially decompose the items, and then you reassemble them in a different order. How he explained it was, he just doesn't assemble it again. So when he destroys shit, he just like halfway
does the one arm alchemy. The one arm just destroys. Yeah. It's literally all that one does. It just destroys. But the other one can fix and heal and semi-create a little bit.
At least they stick with the motif, like, you can't bring somebody back, like, unlike fucking JoJo, which, like, oh, you can't bring somebody back to life, continues to bring everyone back to life.
Yeah, like...
God,
I love Full Metal so much. It's so... Like, the stuff that they have to go through in that show is just crazy.
Yeah.
I love it. And just the way that their system works, it's like... It's rigid without being, like, restrictive. You can do a lot of things with your alchemy if you train in a specific way. Like you said, like, Mustang has fire, which in that world, fire was, like, it took them forever to get fire alchemy down. So much so that Mustang is the only one who can do it. And like, he didn't even make it. Like, his partner, like, Riza, Hawkeye's dad, created it, I believe. And then had it tattooed on her back to the secret of fire alchemy. And then after he died and Mustang got more or less that knowledge, Riza and her dad, before he passed away, agreed that this should not be in the hands of anyone. And so they agreed to burn her back to hide the rest of the information about fire alchemy. It's really crazy.
Yeah, and I've only seen the original. I haven't seen Brotherhood, technically, so a lot of this information is new to me.
Yeah, Brotherhood is the much more closer to the manga.
Yeah, because
I think when the original one came out, the manga was not finished.
Yeah,
so they just they had to do what they had to do, which, I mean, it's all right. It's not my cup of tea, but...
Speaking of unfinished shit, we can move over to Bleach now, because I want to talk about this.
That's the saddest finish.
I know nothing about Bleach, so now you get to... back and just absorb all this in.
Okay, I want to talk about a handful of things with Bleach, but one of them is, in the first like episode, they establish that the main character can like see spirits and stuff.
Okay.
And he's just like, okay, you know, maybe I'm just weird. But Soul Reaper, which is just like a Shinigami, which is, you know, God of Death. They go and collect, you know, random souls that are just kind of hanging out and should be in the afterlife.
Kind of like a Grim Reaper, or?
Yeah.
They're almost exactly Grim Reapers.
Yeah, they're Grim Reapers. Yeah. They just have swords and they look like people instead of, you know.
We're the Soul Collection Agency.
That's pretty much what they are. There's a lot of shit that they do, but I don't want to get into that right now. But their main form of a weapon is called a Zanpakuto, which is, it in its basic form, it just looks like a regular katana. And, like, everyone's kind of looks different. Like, it has a different hilt or a different length or, you know, handle. It's just, they all pretty much look the same. But they have two other forms called the Shikai and the Bankai. Now, the Shikai... If you've trained long enough, pretty much anybody can activate it. But the Bankai is, like, only royal families, captains, or very, very, very strong people can actually activate their Bankai. Which is, like, the fucking end-all, be-all ability. It's, like, their, you know, ace in the hole. But there are some Shikai that are so fucking strong. Like, the main villain for most of the season, his Shikai is the ability of, I forget what it's called. It's a perfect illusion where he can make something, he can make nothing appear however he wants. So, like, he made his dead body that people were, like, opening up, like, you know, the doctor, like, opened it up and, like, no, he's fucking dead, like, made it look bleeding, but there was nothing there.
Huh.
Yeah, so, like, he just peaced out, and that's how he just kind of got away. He's so strong. And, you know, there's, like, a lot of really cool abilities out there. Like, there's one girl who she can shoot fireballs every time she swings her sword. Another guy doubles the weight of whatever he hits. So, like, if he strikes your sword twice, it's now four times heavier than it was before. And he can just do that infinitely. The main characters, Ichigo, his sword sucks. Like, his Bankai is just, like, I guess people get hype about it, but, like, his sword just becomes smaller and he becomes a faster and stronger version than what he was before. Like, it doesn't do a whole lot. Oh, God, it's just... And then they have, like, another form of magic called Kido, I think. I might be saying that wrong, but it's essentially just, like, their version of magic. Like, not everyone can do it, but, like, people who've trained, you know, long and hard can do it, essentially. And I think there's 100 of them, like, 100 spells or whatever, and they have to say the name of it, and then it'll activate it. But something they do really cool, and this is kind of transitioning to the next thing we talk about, but something they do really cool in the very first episode is the main girl, Rukia, who's a Soul Reaper, locks up Ichigo in the first seal thing, which is just like a binding spell. And it's like, it's the lowest level thing you can possibly learn, so it's like obviously the weakest out of their entire arsenal. And she's just like, oh yeah, no, he's never going to be able to break out of that, he's just a human. And he's, like, sitting there, like, trying his hardest, and he finally breaks out of it. And I'm like, okay, that's cool. He broke out of it because, obviously, he's kind of special. And, like, she's like, yeah, anybody my level can do that. But, like, regular human, now, fuck that. They can't break out of this. So it's a good way of showing how, yes, he is stronger than a regular human, but he's obviously not, like, fucking I am God. Let me fight shit.
Yeah, he's not great from the get-go.
Yeah. But
you're gonna have to work at this.
and that's cool because that's the very it's like Hakuden number one or whatever, so it's the lowest level. But then, like, way later on in the fights, they have they show this one called the Black Sarcophagus, which is like number 90. Like, it's not the highest, but it's fucking up there. Like, not everyone, nearly nobody can do this one. And the main villain fucking uses it, and they're like, oh my god, it's the Black Sarcophagus. No one is supposed to be able to use that. And then it just breaks because the one guy he used it on was just, quote-unquote, so strong. And it kind of makes me sad because they never actually show that or any high-level stuff being used effectively. Because every time they use something so high-powered, it immediately gets broken to show how strong the character is.
They wharf effect all of
it. Yeah, they wharf effect it. But if, like, it would work if they showed it working before. Yeah. Like, it only works for the low level one because it's like, oh, this is obviously the lowest level one it can get. He should be able to break out of this.
Yeah.
But when they're doing, like, the highest level shit and this is the first time you've seen it and they just break it, you're like, well, I don't know how fucking strong that is. Like...
Oh, yeah.
It just did nothing.
Like, use that shit to kill a huge thing and then try it on him.
Yeah, they just say it's super rare and powerful, but like, they don't actually ever show us how powerful it is.
Like, they show it three times, and every single time it gets broken. It has never been used successfully. And I'm like, well, what is the fucking point then? Oh, God. Lighting. And this, all right, this brings me into my next subject, which is... good powers that have, well, not necessarily next episode, but it's like how they have ruined abilities like that. Like, that's an example. Like, they did really good with the very first couple episodes of Bleach and establishing how strong the main character actually is, but then they ruin it when they're like, oh my god, it's the highest level thing and he broke it, no problem. I want to talk about Avatar The Last Airbender and Legend of Korra specifically, and I'm going to talk to Jared about this a lot.
Uh-huh.
Avatar,
my friends.
So The Last Airbender, they did the Avatar state correctly.
Yes.
He was a fucking baller, and he lost one fight in the Avatar state, and that's because he got a sneak attack struck by lightning, by the main villain. So it's like, yes, that is exactly how that, if he were to lose, that's how he should have lost.
Can I just say on a side note that Legend of Korra and Avatar The Last Airbender also a fantastic magic system?
Oh yeah, we'll talk about that in just a second, but I want to fucking, this drives me nuts. Legend of Korra uses her fucking Avatar state so much, and she gets her ass handed to her constantly in it. Like, I haven't watched much of Legend of Korra, but just the clips I've seen, like, she enters the Avatar state, and then the metal-bending woman just, like, is like, nah.
Okay, wait, hang on, can I say one thing real fast? I feel like Korra set, a really bad precedence when, like, Avatar, his whole journey is him, like, slowly developing his powers and getting to that point, when Korra literally just shows, like, in Korra, they walk into her house and she's using all of her powers, and they're like, well, okay.
She's using everything but air, which, to be fair, for the show, that takes her years to actually, like...
But that doesn't make, like, she should have trouble with firebending. Because it's her opposite element. Aang had a lot of trouble with earthbending. He didn't like fire because it was, you know, scary, but, like...
Yeah, but her mentality is very different than Aang. She couldn't do air well because she wasn't very at inner peace with herself or very spiritually attached, which is basically what the entire first season is her realizing that she's not super great at everything and that she needs to adapt and learn to be able to do this one last thing that she needs to learn in order to be like the full-fledged Avatar with knowing all four elements.
Real quick, I do want to set a precedence. I don't hate Legend of Korra. I don't like it as an Avatar continuation.
I feel like they just really didn't want to give Korra a journey, like as much of a journey as Aang, so they just gave her, they just made her really pretty good at all of the elements instead of Aang's journey of like one by one getting them.
And like, I'd love to the idea of a modern airbender or a modern Avatar. That is fucking sick, but it's just...
Oh yeah, the world was awesome.
Oh god.
Well, to be fair, like, I think they even said it that the creators for Legend of Korra did not think they were going to get a second season. So that's why the first season wraps up so very well and is very well contained as a good beginning and endpoint to a very small series.
Yeah.
It wraps itself up nice. You have a very good main villain. You have an okay story going into it. You have kind of actually actual development with her and the people around her. Does it get better? Yes. Season 2, I think, sadly, is the low point of the series as a whole. But having watched through it multiple times, 3 and 4, I think, do make up for that.
I want to say, though, I absolutely love the fucking the lava bender and the one bender that doesn't have arms, so she makes water arms.
Yeah.
Like, that is some of the coolest shit I've seen in Avatar.
My favorite part about Avatar's power system is the fact that there's, like, these, like, kind of special, rare, like, sub-powers where, like, firebending has lightning bending, waterbenders have blood bending, and then, like, I think, was it earthbenders can, like, bend metal?
Yeah.
And lava.
Oh, I didn't know about the lava thing, but even that sounds
lava,
cool.
Lava is in Korra, which is one guy, and then Bolin can do it.
And
Bolin makes sense because his brother is a firebender, so I see the better connection there. Also, don't forget about explosions.
Oh yeah, fucking shock
the forehead people.
Head.
Yeah, with the two forehead people, because there's two. There's one in Legend of Korra and there's one in Avatar.
Now it's like everyone has their own subset. I really want to know what Air's would be. Like, because they have to have one.
Like, air is scary in itself.
Yeah.
Like, water, I think, is the most diverse out of all of them because there's water in so many things, which they explain, because that's why there's plant bending.
Yeah.
There's bloodbending.
Oh god, plantbending's so cool.
There's a lot of stuff you can do with it. I don't know where sandbending falls into.
That's earthbending.
Yeah, I didn't know if it, I feel like that one is a mix of air and earth. Because a lot of these things have, like, aside from, like, bloodbending,
there's
a
like
lot
cloud
of these have, like,
too.
Have, like, in-between zones.
Yeah, like cloudbending when Aang and Katara were making the clouds look different at one time.
Yeah, because that would be water and air. But most of the elements, like, their in-between stuff, there's a little in-between the four elements where these kind of lie, like, lava is a bit of fire and a bit of earth. Lightning would be technically a little bit of air and a little bit of fire, and metal is just more refined earth. There's not really an in between on that one. Sand, I think, is a close air and water or air and earth one.
I want to talk about one thing in the Legend Core that pisses me. This is the one thing other than her using the Avatar State that actually genuinely pisses me off about the series.
Is it anything in season 2?
I don't know. I haven't seen past season 1. I've seen snippet. Okay. No. I know. I need to watch it. I couldn't get past season 1.
I finished season 1, and then I forgot. Like, I never even knew that the second season aired. And by the time
I
realized, by the time I realized that there was more than one season, the entire show is over.
But I want to talk about this. I absolutely fucking hate how they handled airbenders. It pisses me off to no end. Okay, in the original series, they talk about the origins of bending and how the waterbenders learned from the moon, the airbenders learned from the bisons, the firebenders learned from the dragons, and the earthbenders learned from the giant mole creatures.
Yeah.
That's awesome. What should have happened is the people should have been at the air temples practicing their way of life and just, like, living like nomads again. And do they have sky bisons now?
There are very few, but there are a couple. They get shown in after
the airbenders.
I'm
also curious as to how the hell that happened. But
after the airbenders, there are more sky bison. They look slightly different, but they're still sky bison.
Probably like a crossbreed from Appa or whatever. But what should have happened is the sky bison should have just been like, they should have been practicing the sky bison's like moves or whatever, is, you know, something along those lines. It shouldn't have just awoken in people. Like, I hate that. I hate that so much. That just some Joe Schmo 200 years after the last fucking airbender died is now has the ability to just use air.
Are airbenders fucking Jedi?
That is another thing I want to talk about. Korra has the same problem as the fucking midichlorians do, how it ruins the force. It shouldn't be that, like, it shouldn't just appear in people. It should have been, like, a technique or something that you can learn and master, not just like, oh, you're strong in this.
I mean, Avatar is still similar to that. Like, yes, you trained, but if you couldn't do the bending to begin with, it's kind of hard to get training. Aang knows how to airbend. Aang, as inherently as the Avatar, knows how to waterbend and earthbend and firebend. He still needed training. But if you just can't do the thing, like, there's still plenty of normal people in Avatar.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
So it makes more sense for after the events that happened in season 2, when more or less the airbenders get brought back, it makes sense to, because most of the people who could airbend, they're like, what do you mean I'm an airbender?
Yeah, that's why it pisses me off. I don't think they should be airbenders. I think that the people practicing the nomadic, like, bullshit should be the airbenders.
You mean all, like, 5 of them?
Yes. I would be fine
they're
with,
already
like, 5
airbenders
or 10 of them.
Because it's already Tenzin and his family. Tenzin and his family.
No, they're
all
there
airbenders.
Are monks practicing the fucking air nomad way, just without the powers. They're inhabiting the other temples.
They're just... Yeah, they're just, well, no, they're all pretty much just on Air Temple Island.
Yeah, that's fine. Like, I would be completely okay with them getting the power. It could just appear to them, and I'd be more okay with that. But just some fucking Joe Schmo standing on a bridge now has the ability
to
control air.
I mean,
the fact that Aang's kids, because he had 3 of them, because he had Tenzin, he has Bumi, and he has, I forget what her name was, Kaya? Yeah, Kaya. Mm. Bumi's still normal.
Yeah.
Bumi is normal until the whatever happens with that, and then he's an airbender.
Yeah, but
so there's
oh, wait,
no
he,
like,
wait, he gets the airbending shit.
Yeah.
Oh,
Okay, well, okay, so before I was agreeing with Jarrett, but that one's retarded. okay, so I agree that, like, everybody had, like, maybe with, like, a few cases of, like, you know, no benders, but, like, I feel like everybody has the inherent power in them, they just have to, you know, develop it. Like, a guy could maybe, like, nut, like, an earthbender who obviously never has it, like, but never practice, he can maybe nudge a rock, but he has to practice if he wants to do that, like, that cool, like, stomp punch thing.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like it makes sense. It was like, but like, how does it work? Is it like bloodlines, or is it just like the world is a balance? So
okay,
if there's a underdevelopment of airbenders, mortal.
But that doesn't make sense though, if that's the case, because it's been 200 fucking years since the Holocaust for the airbenders, because it was 100 years after Aang was frozen, so there was no airbenders for 100 years, except for Aang frozen in a fucking iceberg in the middle of nowhere. And then Aang lived, like, his entire life, and then airbenders showed up.
Yeah, but I mean, like...
Well, his Tenzin was airbender, and then Kaya was a waterbender? Yeah. And then Boomy was just normal.
Yeah, but why did they show up then? Why didn't they show up after fucking Fire Nation destroyed all the airbenders?
I don't know. Maybe the cycle had to reset. I don't know, man.
Yeah, I mean, like,
all I know is what happened in season two, and the end of season two is what causes the airbenders to come back, because it's a hold. The end of season two kind of makes sense, but it's a long bit.
I mean, logically,
that don't make sense, but that part kind of makes sense when it happens. But I'm not gonna tell you because you need to freaking watch it.
I think logically, what should have happened is like. After all the airbenders were wiped out, almost all of the babies born after that should have been airbenders.
Yeah, like, if it was the whole keep balance thing, like, every baby should have been an airbender after that.
Yeah, until there was another balance. Because I do believe that there has to be an inherent ability to do it, but then I'm not really sure if it's the balance thing or if it's a bloodline thing, because, you know, they're in nations. So yeah. it seems like it would be a bloodline, but then, like, that just doesn't make any sense, really. And, like, it obviously can't be the practice thing, because then everybody could be the Avatar if they just tried hard enough.
Yeah, it's this weird... I mean, they explain how the Avatar works, and I don't like that personally, just because I hate that fucking, oh, the good and the evil bullshit. But,
I mean, humanity and stuff in general is based off duality, so if you don't like that, then I'm sorry to tell you, a lot of life is like that.
But the whole point of the end of fucking, season, or the end of the original Avatar, is that he doesn't want to kill because that's bad. He wants a neutral ending. He doesn't want him to live, like, have his bending anymore, but he doesn't want to kill him. Yeah. Like, I don't know. It's like the gray Jedi argument. It's like, are they good guys?
Yeah, it's just neutral. What makes a man decide to turn neutral?
Sorry. Alright. Yeah, so Avatar definitely has its good, but it also has its kind of confusing downsides. I feel like we should move on to
hold on. Okay, we're going to talk about confusing downsides. Then we're going to have to talk about Bantora.
Oh, boy. All
God, right. I love these transitions. This is like the third great transition in a row.
Because,
all right, let's talk about Bantora, Jared.
I specifically for this, I was curious if they ever explained how their powers work in Bantora. So, Book of Bantora, basically the general small synopsis. I'm not going to go into too detail because this is getting its own episode. So I won't go into too full detail. Basically, when you die, your memories, and you get turned into a stone book.
Your soul becomes a stone tablet.
Yes, right. Which then you will more than likely end up going to the Library of Bantora.
Well, yeah,
an island down the middle of the ocean.
Yeah, like, a guy can essentially come to your dead body, put a sword in you, and pull out a book, which is a stone tablet that has your entire life in it, essentially. Yeah. And then people will usually take these to this place called the Bantora Library, which is where they keep all of the books.
Which are also guarded in a basically a labyrinth by monsters.
I mean, that's, kind of guarded. It's, oh god, the ending. We'll get to the ending of the day, but
We'll get to that. But there are these people who are called armed librarians, and they are the defenders of Bantora, and also kind of the world. And you know,
they have like the library has monsters at each floor. There's like what, 5 floors?
Yeah, I think it's 5 floors.
And every level has like more intense monsters guarding the books. Like the monsters don't care about the books, but they'll attack fucking anybody that shows up. So essentially, you have to be pretty strong to fight off the monsters so you can put the books away. Because like when you kill them, they turn to sand and then they come back to life somewhere else.
Yeah.
In the library.
Yeah.
So
pretty much the monsters keep coming back. They're just all the same.
It's like there's no like, oh, you have to be level 3 to get in here. It's like no, you just have to be strong enough to survive to get in here.
Yeah, but with this, pretty much all of the armed librarians have a special power. We don't know how they get these powers. That's never really explained.
They never talk about that.
They never. I looked it up for almost an hour trying to find if there was any mention of it. I could not find anything. So there is a variety of powers. There is one dude who can swim through solid objects.
Oh, he's so cool.
There is Mirapok, who it just has like full on telepathy, strong telepathy.
Anywhere in the world, she can talk to you.
Anywhere in the world. She is their main source of communication for the armed librarians.
Yeah.
There is who was the one old lady who she had like localized time control?
Oh yeah, she could just she just could straight up manipulate time, and then
she could like stop time for herself, stop time in a small area, slow down time, speed up time, whatever and such.
I remember she was like getting swarmed by. It sounds weird. She's getting swarmed by ants, and so she just froze herself solid.
That
so
guy.
That, oh god, that guy's crazy. Dude.
Oh, that guy is insane.
He lives on, like, what, the 3rd or 4th floor of the library?
Yeah, he just lives there.
He can control ants, but, like, not just any ants, like, the strongest fucking ants you've ever seen.
And like, he literally wipes out an entire army by himself.
Oh, yeah, they're like, oh, yeah, no, he killed, like, this massive army single-handedly. And they're like, oh, no, he didn't, and then...
But they also gave him trauma because he also killed a lot of children.
Yeah.
So...
He's
he
like
has
in a
some
childlike
issues.
State. The main, oh god, I don't want to say person. What's her face?
Hatsume or
Mesida. Big Kitty. What's her face?
Hayutes Mesida.
Hamutes Mesida. Hamutes. She has this insane ability called sensory threads, where these. Almost near, I think they're invisible essentially to the naked eye. These threads,
pretty
like,
much invisible.
Stem from her, and it's about the like radius of a city. And she knows everything that's going on as long as her sensors are like anywhere close to that. And like she's naturally strong and fast and like just all this other shit, but her weapon is essentially a slingshot, like one of those like old timey ones where you swing it above your head and then you let it go and it goes flying.
Yeah, it's a sling.
Sling. The coolest fucking scene is when she's standing on top of a building before a storm, just killing people by just launching these fucking rocks out into just nowhere, and then they just land and murder somebody that she wanted to kill. Like, oh, so
but there's
cool.
Also my favorite character out of this show that I have so many issues with, but he's still my favorite character, of Madalast, who can see 2 seconds into the future. He sees 2 seconds in the future,
and he has
but
a gun.
Boy, does he make so much use out of that, and he has a gun. That's his only other thing, is he just has a gun. He's a well-dressed man, can see 2 seconds in the future, has a gun. He uses that 2 seconds to his advantage every single time, because I think one of the best parts is, like his eyes flicker, and he's like, oh, they're going to be dropping on the ceiling, you're going to move over there. And then you just see a bunch of people fall through the ceiling, like, coming after them, and he just shoots them all. He's like, alright, there you go.
Yeah.
God, that's awful. Katakuri again.
Oh god, what else?
There was also Minth, who could see the hearts of people. Like, he could see into their hearts.
Get,
like, their true stuff. There, Vulcan could just make clones of himself.
I hate Vulcan. Vulcan is, like...
Everybody hates
in
Vulcan.
In the intro, the way that it's framed, because, like, they show, you know, like, a static shot of all the people standing there, Vulcan is literally the closest character to the camera and taking up the most amount of screen space. He is gone for a majority of season 2.
Yeah.
And then he, like, oh god, fucking spoiler alert, he dies like a little bit after he gets back. So it is, oh, I hate Vulcan so much.
But this is also the weird thing with the powers, is that there's just people who are really good who don't have powers, like Nautilee. No powers. She's really good at hand-to-hand combat.
Does she? I thought she had, like, strength or something. No, nothing, I'm thinking of...
No, she has nothing. But then you can also have someone like Shirin, the weird calico-looking girl, who her ability is, she has the ability to look far into the future. It's because of this ability that she also falls in love with someone 3 centuries
after she's born. Yeah, I forgot about that.
Where she falls in love with Julio Tonies.
Yeah, and so she dies, becomes a book. He finds her book and looks through her memories, and she's like communicating with him.
Oh yeah, yeah. She can also talk with people if they're by her book.
3,000 years into the future, so there's like a love story.
Only 300, not 3,000. No, 3 centuries. Yeah, so 300.
It's, oh god, that shit gets convoluted.
And then there's like, you know that someone else also had sensory threads?
Hmm.
The violin girl.
Did she have sensory threads?
Yeah.
I'm gonna have to watch Bantor, like the beginning of Bantor, to see if they explain fucking anything.
I have been looking up, there is nothing to explain how they get these powers, why they have these powers, or what any limitations there are for them. There is nothing, which drives me up the wall thinking back at it even more. I already had issues with this show. This has just increased my issues with it. I'm not trying to be spiteful about like the whole Legend of Korra stuff. I understand Legend of Korra is not for everyone. There are some inconsistencies. There's inconsistencies in Avatar too.
Yeah.
But Bantora, man, like it's just, there's so much shit weird with it, and I can't wait to get to its own episode.
Oh yeah, that's gonna be fun.
Oh man.
You dumping like, on at me, like, no, it's good though.
Yeah, like Legend of Korra and Book of Mantora are both of our shows that were like, no, we swear it's good. While the other is just kind of going at it.
God. And then I don't, well, see, that's a situation where you don't like how they explain where the powers come from. Like, would you want to know where the powers came from in Bantora?
I'm someone who I'm one of those readers and watchers who, like, I want at least a base explanation for why this is. Even though quirks themselves are like, hey, they just kind of showed up one day, they still have other things that give them like a framework of how they work.
Okay.
Not everyone has it. There's this small tell that you can tell what they are. People, it's not just like a random lottery. It is kind of a random lottery, but it's like, you're not just stuck with what you have. You can train and make it better.
Well, how do you feel about One Punch Man then?
Oh, no, it's just his sheer training.
Well, yeah.
Not only just the powers in the world. What I love about One Punch Man is that it doesn't take it seriously, so they don't explain the powers at all.
Yeah. Oh god.
I mean, One Punch Man, I don't take a lot of issue with that one. I treat it as a comedy, not as an action. So yeah. I'm a lot more lenient with stuff on that. It's crazy as it is, like, hard work and determination, like, it fits in the anime world. Like, there's a certain give and take that I...
But yeah, the fucking main guy in One Punch Man is just... I want to say he has a power, but I don't want to know. I want to leave it ambiguous.
Well, no, I'm not talking about Saitama. Like, I get the joke that's, like, I hope it's just the joke that he trained really hard. But I'm talking about, like, literally any other character, like... There are characters.
Psychic Lolly, fuck Tornado.
Yeah, there's Terrible Tornado or whatever her name is, something like Twisted. That. No,
fucking.
But there's one of the S class heroes is Zombie Man. He's literally immortal.
Or there's the fucking Watchdog.
Watchdog Man. I don't think they ever explained his powers. He's just really strong.
Yeah.
but one of the characters in S class. Is Zombie Man, and like one of the OVAs, he dies and then he just comes back. Like, his power is that he just can die and come back. I was like, how does that work in this world?
And that's like a good version of like, hey, this doesn't make sense, fuck you.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, One Punch Man is definitely like That's why it's usually put with the parody tag. It's a parody of those superhero.
Yeah, that's true.
It's overdone superhero things.
But, I mean, getting back to like tropes and stuff, we can talk about the melancholy of Haruhi Suzumiya a little bit, because how it's like a regular school life, but there is an alien, a god, a esper, a time traveler.
Is there a witch in that one?
No.
I haven't watched it, but I feel... But I've heard you do like the rundown of basically what's in it.
Yeah.
And I could swear that witch was one of them.
And that's another example of like, hey, yeah, these powers are prevalent, but they're not like... The story can exist without them. It's just like another kind of plot device.
Yeah.
And that's like, that's a weird example of like, I can't really think of many other shows where it's like, if this narrative didn't exist, like the whole show would be ruined.
I mean, I feel like if someone disagrees that can't be proven, literally, if you just watch the spinoff, the disappearance of Nagi, whatever the one girl, the alien girl's name is,
mm-hmm.
they made a spinoff specifically set in the movie universe where she's the main character, and so it's just Haruhi without powers or anything strange. It's just normal.
That's weird. God, and that's such a like good example of like a really powerful character that just does. I don't want to say like is portrayed well, like All Might and One Punch Man, and they're all portrayed very well, but they know their powers. But she's like, yeah, she's God, but like she's also a high school girl. You know what up?
Yeah, that's what I love about it. It's like she's all powerful, but she doesn't know about her powers. So it just kind of happens. Like it just kind of happens with her feelings. Like. The one Esper dude explains, like, whenever she has a fluctuation in feelings, these giant monsters are created and he has to kill them.
Like, could you imagine if, like, she gets into a really deeply romantic relationship and then, like, he cheats on her or something? Like, the fuck would happen?
I mean, that happened, like, that essentially happens in, like, the first season where her and him are stuck in the parallel universe because he was a little bit too friendly with the time traveler.
Oh, yeah! Oh, God.
Because, like, he's teasing her, and she gets so mad about it that she creates a universe.
With, like, nobody else in it but them.
Huh.
I forget how, like, much... Because I just keep thinking of, like, the episodes where nothing happens, but I always forget that there's a lot of actually intense shit that happens in that.
Yeah, and then there's, like, even, like, things that just are on her whim, like... Oh, like, I hate to bring it up,
She
doesn't want Summer... She doesn't want Summer to end... So she creates an endless time loop of Summer happening forever.
Yeah, and it's 8 straight episodes of the exact same thing, just from, like, different angles.
Yeah, but the less we talk about, the better.
Oh, God. That's...
All right.
That episode hurts me inside.
Yeah.
Getting away from
I don't know how to feel about that one.
Getting away from normal schoolgirls, let's get into some weird schoolgirls with Keijo. Their power system is fucking weird.
Are we bringing Keijo up in this?
Might as well.
Okay then. I got one more after this, which is in a very different direction. But yeah, no, Keijo. Okay then.
I mean, like, ooh. Yeah, Keijo's like seems like techniques, but then there's shit like the wolf butt. I don't remember. It's like.
Cerberus.
Is it Cerberus? Yeah, it's
Cerberus.
Oh god, it's just a sentient spirit thing? I can't remember what the exact explanation is.
It's basically a stand.
Yeah. Just an ass stand.
Like
a hypno titties.
My favorite power in the whole one is Gates of Bootylon.
There you go.
Dude, Gates of Bootylon is the most epic fucking thing in that entire show.
Yeah, it's the most like it's a reference to freaking Fate Stay.
Oh, yeah. Oh, because I saw that finally with the Battle Cats thing when they had the Fate Stay attack, which he did the Gates of... I know, I'm going like multiple levels deep on this.
What an odd, just like... Yeah, I know, I saw this in a cat mobile game.
Because in Fate Stay, there's a move called Gates of Babylon, where he opens up portals with different swords in them, and that's what Gates of Bootylon is a reference to.
But they're just asses.
Yeah, she has the ability to copy every other woman's ability if she massaged their
their butts at any... No, I think she just touches them, because they do that one thing where she just, like...
No, she massaged them.
Oh, God, the show.
Because they set up they set up that entire, like... What was it? Was it during the tournament, or, like, right before, where they set up that entire thing? I was like, oh, hey, we're giving them massages.
Oh, yeah. And then, fuck, the main character, what, she just... The vacuum butt cannon, if I remember that correctly.
The hip whip cannon.
Oh, God.
Where she can whip so fast that it causes air pressure ripping the other person's clothes. And I loved, like, their explanation. It was like, you can't use this power. It's too powerful. You'll break your hips.
And then, oh man, what is the final, like, fight? I forget what her opponent has.
What did her final opponent?
Her opponent seemed really strong.
The final opponent was, like, crazy because she had, like, a split personality where she started off as one, but then, like, something happened and she went to a much darker version of herself. She was like, well, now you're messing with me.
Hold on, I gotta look this up now.
So I remember that one of their teammates had, like, the iron butt of, like,
Something
like that. Where her butt just, like, became, like, iron. I'm like, ah. Someone on the enemy team had that, and they went against a girl with a squishy butt, and it just, like...
Oh, yeah, oh, soft buns. God,
it's just absorbing it. Yeah, oh, yeah, soft buns. It's just absorbing it.
Oh, God, she did that one thing where, like, she bounced her boob, and it, like... She made a shockwave, that's right. Like, she slammed them together, and it made, like, a weird shockwave. Oh, Keijo's the weirdest fucking anime.
Oh, man. So good, though. Highly recommend.
It's just My Hero, like, the ichi fucking borderline hentai.
If we're talking about weird, I wanna talk about a really obscure anime that's my favorite bad anime, which is Dansai Bunny no Crime Edge. Which, it's really cool because it's like essentially all of the characters are descendants of serial killers that inherited their weapons. And it's like, if they don't kill or have a substitute for killing, then they will consume the bloodlust, which is my favorite concept of it, because, like, every character who isn't, like, either, like, a murderer or insane, they'll have, like, a substitute character where they, like, the main character, he has scissors, so he cuts this girl's hair. One girl has a needle, so she injects her sister with, like, stuff that's, like, non-harmful. And then there's, like, a piano girl who can kill people with a piano, so she plays it for a deaf guy. And I love, like, the concept of,
like, how they have to be creative about it.
Yeah. Yeah, like the whole substitute murder thing is, like, my favorite part of this just laughably bad anime.
And so, Jerry, you said you had one more you wanted to talk about.
Well, from substitutes to murder to actual murder.
There you go, perfect transition.
Dead Man Wonderland.
Oh yeah, you said you wanted to talk about that. Yeah. I know nothing about Dead Man Wonderland.
It is one of those, like, very gruesome ones. Like, literally the first season is an entire classroom of people getting massacred with only one guy living, and then he gets sent to Dead Man Wonderland, which is an amusement park prison.
Uh-huh.
It's very, very crazy, where it's literally they host a TV show where it's basically just, like, it's like Death Race, but for, like, superpowered people. Because this kid, like, literally when his entire class gets massacred, it's by this, like, giant floating villain-looking person who then basically shoves a red crystal into his chest, and he lives. But now he can control his blood to, like, crazy, crazy degrees.
Huh.
And that's pretty much everyone that's in Dead Man Wonderland has those powers to differing, like, degrees of what they can do with them. But they're all basically the same ability, that they're all blood-based powers. Like, one person can coat their fist and body in blood and harden it to be very damaging but very protective. The main character uses his as a gun, so he'll make, like, his finger bleed, and he'll just fire the blood out like bullets.
That's pretty cool.
Other people can make shields. There's one. The main they call him the Red Man, who is the person who massacres the entire the classroom. Like, they can turn their blood into like hexagons, but like chains of hexagons, and they just basically saw through everything with it. It's a very singular thing. It's like, hey, these people can only use their blood, but they can use them in such a variety of ways that it's very interesting to see how they get used.
So, okay, so kind of wrapping it up because we're almost about to hit 2 hours and I want to try to keep these under 2 hours.
Yeah.
What are some of the powers that you would like to have and what are the reasons behind that?
Can we go by like show?
Genre. All right, like, so we'll start out with like stands. What is a stand ability that exists currently that you would want to have?
Is it just a stand? Was it Shining Diamond? Shining Diamond?
Yeah, Shining Diamond.
That was crazy.
No,
crazy.
Diamond. Shine on crazy. Crazy Diamond.
Crazy Diamond. I like healing abilities. I really like his. I really like his stand because it's just a heal. It's just a stand that heals things, but like he uses it in very creative ways.
Yeah,
I've only seen up to season 3, so I would honestly want Hermit Purple.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh. We gotta explain to you the passion at some point.
Not super offensive, but I like the utility of Hermit Purple.
Underutilized. Yeah. In
I almost want to say that I would choose Death 13 just because I love the concept of an entire world where just shit doesn't make sense and you're like the only one that can really control stuff. But the fact that it has like you have to be asleep for it to work is kind of
I mean, people need sleep.
I mean, I guess, you know.
Unless they catch on, you're pretty well set.
Well, it's hard for them to catch on because they forget everything.
Yeah.
The
only reason he figured out is because he carved it into his arm.
Yeah.
But, like, I don't know. See, my thing was, like, I would want a kind of a simple one that I could just figure out how to use, like, insanely. Like, the lock is really cool because it's just, like, you weighed down by your fucking burdens and stuff.
Yeah, I don't know. I didn't like how oddly specific that is.
Yeah. Yeah, like, if it wasn't as crazy or it's like, oh, well, because they kind of did something similar with Civil War. Where it's like your past comes back to haunt you kind of deal.
I thought you were going to mention the girl from Part 8 where if you dote on her or if you worry about her, then she can use her ability.
Oh, God. Oh, her ability is so weird. I forget what it's even fucking called.
It was like California. No.
It might be California King Bed.
Might have. Yeah, I know California King Bed is one.
But I don't know. If I had to just pick one stand, that'd probably be Killer Queen, just because I fucking love.
You want to put bombs and everything?
I fucking love it.
I mean, Killer Queen is
Killer
like.
Killer Queen was my second choice, but I'm like, that's really destructive, and I don't think I would also go for something like that.
Killer Queen is the strongest stand, like, no doubt. It is, like, not counting, like, the super crazy ones, like, Over Heaven. It is, like, essentially one of the strongest stands ever.
Mm hmm. Because it just works, but
Avatar stuff, bending.
Oh yeah, if you had to pick one of the four bending things, what would you pick?
Waterbender. I never really thought about what power I really want, and I don't know enough about the universe to know like those like weird subsets besides like lightning bending.
I'd probably be a waterbender just because I think the concept of bloodbending is really interesting.
Yeah, I feel like waterbending has the most utility. So
it's also funny because Zach like water. I would say waterbending for you because it's also one of the closest healing ones. Anthony took that in the complete opposite direction of the waterbending. I don't think able to control people.
Well, I also want to mention this real quick. Oh, fuck, what was I going to say? Oh, yeah, it's like firebenders are one of the stronger ones because they don't need their element around them to activate it.
I mean, I say air, but air is everywhere.
Yeah, so things like you can't really test that because if there's a vacuum in space, it's like nobody will be able to use their bending, so.
Yeah.
Kind of up to the ground. God, that's why Avatar's so good. Like, they knew to take out the air nomads first.
I would say air. So good. I would like airbending.
If I was a waterbender, you know I would just do exactly what I did in our one D&D game. My character was essentially a waterbender, and he just kept two water bottles on his side and just, like, popped them open. It's like, okay, let me use my power.
That's what Katara does all the time in the first season.
Yeah.
She just...
She's like a little water sack she just uses to attack people.
I went inside and was like, don't use your bending water on me, after she, like, hoses him down with it.
Or yeah, they drink it, and they're like, oh, God, this tastes horrible. It's like, well, yeah.
It's like, it's your bending water.
Use that to fight people.
Yeah.
She just never changes it out, so it's fucking filthy the entire time. Oh, yeah, I forgot about sweat bending, too. That was something that they did.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they use it to escape a prison. A wooden prison. Like, we'll put him in a wooden prison. The earthbender won't be able to do anything. Waterbender just starts sweating.
Shit. What other shows we got?
My Hero. I finally get to talk about this.
Quirks / semblances, because they're so similar. I feel like they'd be.
You guys first, but you guys first, and then I'll talk about my thing.
I'd pick the same thing that I picked for my Ruby game, is that mine would just be rotation, where I can spin things that are smaller than I am.
Why?
Because you can do some crazy shit with that.
Right.
Great for home repair.
Sorry. Like, you have a fucking airplane with no engine, you're just like, yeah, fuck you, I can fly.
I don't really think, like, you know, I always like healing-based abilities, but honestly, I don't think My Hero has very many good, like, healing-based abilities besides, like, the nurse who just kisses people, and I wouldn't want that power.
Well, you won't give me a smooch and make my boo go away.
But this is a weird one, and, like, I like this power for some reason a good bit. I really like Sero's power. I like his ability. Yeah, I really like the tape. I don't know why. It's just really, really cool.
That's not a bad one.
Because he can, like, you know, he can tie people up. He can, you know, in the current arc, he does, like, he essentially does Kakyoin's move against Dio. He does that.
Oh.
With, like, he makes, like, a tape, like whole tape cage thing. And then, like, he can use it. He swings like Spider-Man with it. Like, it has so many utilities.
I really hope at some point the guy that makes My Hero actually does, like, combo attacks, like the fucking thing, the laser thing that we were talking about earlier. And him doing that with Mineta's, like, balls attached to it as well.
God, like, double stick.
Yeah, like, you wouldn't be able to escape that shit.
Okay, so I finally get to talk about mine. The power I would take, because I think this power is wasted on the character that it's with. You guys know the teacher for Class 1B, right? Vlad King?
Vlad King.
Oh, Vlad, yeah.
We're getting back to Vlad-based powers.
I want his power because it is wasted on him. I wanted so bad a character that's in one of the classes to have that ability and not have it be Vlad King. There are so many interesting things you can do with that. And what do we get? We get Vlad King blood taping a dude to a wall.
Well, I mean, we haven't seen Vlad that often, to be fair.
I know, but that's what I'm saying. It's wasted on him because he gets no time at all.
Okay.
He gets nothing.
I have a couple questions about that blood power. Yes. Okay. Is that his own blood, and is it replaced immediately, or does he have a finite amount of blood?
That is my question too. Like, I was imagining if I had that power, I would have to focus on a way of being able to make more, like, not lipids, make to basically be having to chuckle and truce all the time, having to replenish my blood, or if I can get to the point where I could control my blood enough that I can, like, still create blood at a faster rate while also still using it. Because my entire thought is, like, if you are good enough with that ability, you basically can do a lot of things, because granted, some of these ideas are also from Dead Man Wonderland, but being able to make a shield on yourself, if you wanted to, you can make a blood dark shadow if you are that good and had enough blood.
That also brings up the thing, it's like, how long is it out of his body before he can't control it anymore? Because, like, theoretically, if he just, like, every night took, like, a pint of blood out and put it in a barrel, and he just did that, like, every night for the rest of his life, and he could control it afterwards, he would have a fucking ocean of blood at his control.
Yeah, it's like, if you can control it outside of it being attached to your body, that is a limitation. But even still, if you can control it, like, say if it's like a blood tentacle. Say if it is still attached to you, but it's outside your body. As long as you can still control it like that, I'd still be fine with that power. Because then you could still do a lot with that. You could still move around like Spider-Man. You could have the blood dark shadow. You could have really tough skin if you like hardened it to where it's more of the iron is on the outside. Like, that power is so... Not to mention just the story elements of that, because I don't know what the medical situation is in the world of My Hero, but having a hero having to deal with these, with so many things that are based around being in the blood, like disease and stuff, would just be so interesting. Like, does he have to find a way to scrub out stuff from his blood?
Oh.
Can he filter it out?
Do you know what I just thought of, though, that'd be kind of cool?
What?
If he could control his own blood, let's say he had, like, the universal donor blood type. Yeah. And, like, somebody's, like, bleeding out, he could just give them more blood.
Yeah.
Like, that's a really cool ability, because you just prolong until they can get to the fucking hospital.
There are two situations in my head for my, like, I've been thinking about this a lot, and, like, if I was to be a character of My Hero, and that was my power, like, the two fights I would find most interesting would be a fight against Toga, because if I can control the blood outside, you know how she has the weird, the tubes basically attached to needles? Basically, either, I don't know how she consumes the blood. I think she drinks it or whatever.
Yeah, I think
she could does. I then control that blood outside? If I can control the blood outside my body, a fight with her is much easier. Plus, I could probably destroy whatever rig she has. If it's like she stabs me and is like, I got your blood. And I'm like, okay. Nah. Rips the entire thing apart. Also, I would love to see what a fight with Stain would be. Because Stain stops you from being able to move.
Yeah.
But if you don't need your body to move your blood and you just need your brain, how does that fight go then? Can I still control my blood? Because Deku and everyone is still able to like talk and think and everything. They just can't physically move. But if I don't need to physically move to enable my quirk, then I think a blood fight with Stain is a lot more interesting.
Maya. You know who could beat Black King? Bakugo's dad.
Sweats a lot.
It's the best quirk in the whole series. Just sweating a lot. The only reason it works is just because he passed it down to Bakugo, which made his quirk really strong.
Just made his sweat nitroglycerin.
I do want to mention my favorite character from Bleach. This was never animated, sadly, but this is in the manga. His Bankai is this thing called the Blood Princess. Oh, it is, like, the sickest shit. Because, essentially, there's, like, I think it's, like, six types of Zanpakuto. There's, like, magic-based, there's fire, ice, lightning, water. Ice and water are two very different things, also. And then blood is one of them.
Uh-huh.
Blood is, like, really rare, apparently, but it's so fucking cool. Like, this one character essentially blows his eyes up, and he's like, oh, now you can't see, and he activates it, and his blood reforms as eyeballs, and he can then use them. It's, like, some gross shit, but it is, it's so cool.
Huh.
Yeah. Alright, we should probably wrap it up, because
we probably should.
We're pushing it right now. Any closing thoughts you want to say before we say goodbye?
You two should really watch the last three seasons of Legend of Korra.
Yeah.
Before you start talking about it.
I'll have to watch it before the episode comes up. Or the
I would appreciate that, because I'm going to have to rewatch most of Bantora.
So I'll watch Korra if you rewatch Bantora.
I can agree with that. I have the Blu-rays if you won't bother them, but you're in a different state, much more difficult.
A little far away.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you for joining us. You can find links to everything in the linked up link dump. either down below or I have no fucking idea where it is on SoundCloud, along with our Twitters and other social medias if you feel like following us. As always, we post twice a month, and occasionally we will have a special episode, so be sure to stick around. Next week, please join us for JoJo Part 2.
That's a Battle Tendency.
Battle Tendencies, that's right. We're going to be talking about that in probably a better format than we did last week. So, anyways, have a good day. Thank you for listening.
Bye, Internet.